Will this controversial week become a consequential week in the story of Doug Ford's government? The door might be closed to Greenbelt development, but critics say the scandal is still wide open. Good evening. Another day, another twist in the Ontario halls of power. Tonight, a third cabinet minister is leaving their post.
The new departure following a high-profile apology from the premier himself. CTV's Queen's Park Bureau Chief Siobhan Morris is live with tonight's top story. Siobhan.
Well, Monte McNaughton wants you to know that his departure has nothing to do with any scandal swirling around the government. But the timing, it doesn't look good as the government tries to regain control of the narrative as MPPs return to Queen's Park next week.
He's been one of the most prominent faces of the government.
I, Monte Gary McNaughton.
Now the Minister of Labour is resigning, leaving 12 years of political life for a job in the private sector. Monte McNaughton was key in the re-election of progressive conservatives, forging bonds with private trade unions. He's the third cabinet minister to quit in under a month.
I'm beginning to wonder whether, in fact, we're going to have anybody left to question on Monday at this rate.
Two other ministers left over the Greenbelt scandal, but McNaughton insists this is a long time coming, writing, I realize that recent events will cause some to speculate about the reasons for my departure. I want those people to know that my decision is completely unrelated to those events. I support Premier Ford and am proud to have served in his cabinet. I believe strongly in his team and its vision. David Piccini will take over at Labour, sliding over from Environment. McNaughton's departure comes at a challenging time for the government, trying to get beyond scandal. With an acknowledgement, the Premier broke a promise not to open the Greenbelt for housing.
And for that, I'm very, very sorry.
To try and rebuild trust.
I'll be reversing the changes we made and won't make any changes to the Greenbelt in the future.
But can Ontarians forgive and forget?
We just need more transparency in government in general and for our leaders to not take the public's intelligence for granted.
Hopefully he'll come to his senses and make reverse all his other mistakes as well.
The minister who shares a desk with the premier says he's showing leadership.
He said his motivations were right, but doing the right thing isn't always the right thing to do.
Opposition parties say there are too many unanswered questions to let this go.
How is it that a handful of Premier Ford's friends and fundraisers were set to have an $8.3 billion windfall?
And there are concerns about whether there will be lawsuits, penalties for backtracking.
Certainly hope this doesn't result in Ontarians having to pay out further for this premier and this government's lies and mistakes.
The premier says the housing minister is looking into what's next.
Now, opposition leaders are promising then to keep up the pressure during question period and whatever means they have outside of that, including legislation. There'll also be a very big protest here focused on health care when MPPs return for work on Monday. Reporting live from Queen's Park, I'm Siobhan Morris. Sean, back to you.
Thanks, Siobhan. And you can stay up to date with every development in this story by visiting our website. Our team has a full list of the changes being made in the PC cabinet. That's at ctvnewstoronto.ca, and remember to download the CTV News app. Well, if you have kids in the school system, it's something you've been watching closely. Labor unrest between the province and unions representing teachers and other staff.
Tonight, signs of progress with one group, a tentative deal now reached. CTV's Beth McDonnell is live with more. Beth.
Michelle, the union says the cost of living, inflation, and violence in schools are some of the key issues. Getting to this point, a sign both sides were committed.
It's a new school year, and at elementary schools across Ontario, many parents are looking forward to uninterrupted class time.
It's very important because it's good for the children. Every girl should they go to school. If they one day go, one day stay at home is not good.
A smooth September is looking brighter as ETFO, the Elementary Teachers Federation of Ontario, representing 3,500 education workers, has reached a tentative four-year deal with the provincial government.
This demonstrates progress that we can work together to put our kids first, and we're going to continue to be relentless in ensuring we land deals that protect the in-person learning experience for kids.
Among workers included under this agreement are early childhood educators and professional support personnel in kindergarten programs at public and Catholic schools. ETFO says they are some of the lowest income earners, making under $50,000 a year. And this deal is good news, says its president, Karen Brown.
Issues around compensation were key, but also issues around working conditions, issues around violence, supports for students.
Last fall, 55,000 striking education workers with QP's Ontario School Board Council of Unions shut down schools in a fight over better pay and staffing issues. Educational assistants, custodians, and more garnered a $1 flat rate hourly increase, around a 3.9% raise annually.
I think they laid a foundation that education workers are frustrated, that they're ready to stand up for their collective bargaining rights.
The tentative agreement with ETFO follows an agreement reached with the Ontario Council of Educational Workers and a four-year tentative agreement this August with teachers and education workers with the Ontario Secondary School Teachers Federation. ETFO local presidents and chief negotiators will be looking at this deal next week before it could be ratified. Reporting live, I'm Beth McDonnell. Michelle, back to you.
Thank you, Beth. And staying with our schools, the topic of gender identity, once again the center of a protest here in the GTA.
A gathering outside Victoria Park Collegiate generating an emotional, at times heated, gathering. CTV's Janice Golding is live with more. Janice.
Hi, Sean. Yes, demonstrators on one side called it an education over indoctrination protest, while counter-protesters said that their rally was called Enough is Enough, There's No Space for Hate in Ontario.
God created these children!
A large police presence outside Victoria Park Collegiate today.
Trans rights are human rights.
Demonstrators once again clashing over gender identity education in our schools.
When you're gendering them, you're asking my kid who they want to have sex with. It's not your business.
Students are not being told who to have sex with, who to be. They are learning about this stuff, whether, you know, it's taught in schools, at home, or from their peers.
They are created in the image of God.
Organizers on one side accused educators of exposing children to gender ideology.
I think the body positive message we should be sending our children is that they're beautiful just as they are. This ideology is teaching our children the psychologically abusive nonsense that they might have been born in the wrong body.
Many said they were protesting the premature sexualization and potentially harmful indoctrination of children, but they weren't standing against LGBTQ2S+ people. Still, some of their messaging suggested otherwise.
The role models, the teachers, the principals for this generation are complete degenerates, and they're teaching perversion in their classrooms. They're telling kids to change their genders.
Counter-demonstrators, meanwhile, accused protesters of trying to deny students important lessons about inclusion and acceptance.
The truth of the curriculum is that it just starts to talk in very small ways about the reality that many of these kids already know. They know queer people. They know trans people. It's just reflecting the reality that we all know in our communities. But that isn't the lies these people want people to believe.
I mean, what it reminds me of is a group of people who are closing a circle around whose lives are valuable and worth living and whose lives aren't.
While the debate rages, the Toronto District School Board says its focus
is on the human rights of all of our students and staff and our families. We just want to make sure that everyone feels safe and welcome when they walk through that door of a school.
Meanwhile, following the Canada-wide protests on Wednesday, Prime Minister Justin Trudeau tweeted, "Transphobia, homophobia, and biphobia have no place in this country." Reporting live, I'm Janice Golding. Now back to Michelle.
Thank you, Janice. An update now on a story we mentioned earlier in the week. Durham police have charged two teen girls in connection with a stabbing at a Whitby school. On Monday afternoon, officers were called to Father Leo Austin Catholic School on Dryden Boulevard. They found a 14-year-old girl with stab wounds, and she remains in hospital. That same day, another 14-year-old girl, also a student, was taken into custody. She now faces multiple charges, including assault with a weapon. A 17-year-old girl has also been charged with assault.
Also in Durham Region, we're learning a bit more about an incident Wednesday that saw a woman taken to hospital in critical condition. Investigators previously said she was found early that morning lying on the roadway near Kingston Road and Harwood Avenue. Today, detectives say she's still fighting for her life. They also revealed that the woman is 57 years old and was found with severe head trauma. Anyone with information is asked to call police.
Straight ahead, standing united. Ukraine's president visits Canada as the prime minister pledges more support. The new promise as Toronto prepares to host Volodymyr Zelensky.
A live look outside this hour. It's been a beautiful Friday, which also happens to be the very last day of summer. Can you believe it? Fortunately, as we welcome fall, nature's going to keep the good times rolling. Jessica Smith is outside enjoying the lovely conditions and one of the big events this weekend. Jess?
Sean, Michelle, I'm down here at Berksey Park just for Laughs, the festival. It's already kind of gotten underway, but the street festival begins today, and they have been preparing all day. There are a number of different stages down here, and it has been fantastic. As you kind of get ready to enjoy the weekend, the forecast gets even nicer. As we say so long to, I guess, the official summer season. We had meteorological fall begin on the 1st, the astronomical start to this season, the more widely recognized start to fall begins Saturday just before 3 a.m., but it's bumping down here at the park. Everybody has been getting ready for all of the amazing acts coming in, and it is going to be really exciting. As far as our satellite radar picture goes, there is not too much in the way of any kind of active weather. It has really been beautiful throughout the entire day. High pressure holding on firm. We'll take a look at your temperatures right now. We're kind of in the upper teens, low 20s, so really comfortable to get out and enjoy your evening, whether you're coming down to see the Just for Laughs Festival. There's a number of locations, or maybe you're going out to Nuit Blanche. It's going to be a really exciting weekend. Now, taking a look at what you can expect through the islands over towards Pearson. Again, we're in that upper teen, low 20 range, still a ton of sunshine and a really light wind. As we get through the overnight, we hold on to a lot of that daytime heating, so we are just above the seasonal mark, but still quite comfortable to get out and get active and enjoy Nuit Blanche and all the things that the city has to offer. Coming up, I'll have a full look at your long-range forecast and what you can expect as we settle into the fall season. I'll send things back inside to you guys.
Thanks, Jess. Coming up, officers gather to honor Bingo, the Toronto Police Service dog shot and killed in the line of duty. How the canine is being remembered.
Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky is touching down in Toronto right now, hours after Canada revealed support, new support for the war-torn nation.
Zelensky thanking Canada for its support since the Russian invasion, but also making the case for more military help as the war wages on. CTV's Judy Trin reports.
Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky and his wife arrived on Parliament Hill, greeted with a hero's welcome. When introducing Zelensky, the Prime Minister described the bloody journey that precipitated his trip to Canada.
1 year, 6 months, and 29 days ago, Vladimir Putin launched a full-scale invasion of Ukraine, unleashing a campaign of violence and brutality.
In his speech, Zelensky continued the brutal accounting of Russian aggression.
Our families, whole communities, entire cities, Russia's destruction of Mariupol, of Volnovakha, or Bakhmut, or any other city or village in Ukraine must not go unpunished.
Outside Parliament, teenage Ukrainian refugees who fled the war gathered to urge Canada to help win the war against Vladimir Putin.
He's a terrorist. Of course he is. He's killing my people. He's killing Ukrainian people, Ukrainian children.
Inside, the Prime Minister announced Canada will contribute an additional $650 million to Ukraine's war effort.
A defense that is not just strong because of the support from friends around the world, but because those who fight for their freedom will always fight with their whole hearts.
More armored vehicles will be sent and more expertise to train Ukrainian pilots to fly fighter jets, bringing Canada's total commitment since the start of the war to nearly $2.5 billion. Zelensky, grateful for the resources, used a phrase the Governor General taught him earlier in the day to express solidarity.
Ayunata, she said, the meaning of this word is don't give up. Don't give up, stay strong against all odds. Slava Ukraine!
Canada's renewed commitment comes as support from other NATO countries wane. Poland announced this week that it will stop supplying Ukraine with weapons. Judy Trin, CTV News, Ottawa.
And joining us now to talk about President Zelensky's speech, CTV News national correspondent Kevin Gallagher. Kevin, thanks for joining us.
No problem. My pleasure.
So can you give us a sense, what was the reaction to Zelensky's speech in his first address to Parliament?
Well, of course, this is his first in-person address back in March 2022. He did have a virtual one, but I think the thing that strikes you most, Sean, is that this is a house that often, especially lately, can be quite divided, and all were united as President Volodymyr Zelensky entered. His address was punctuated by multiple standing ovations. He gave great efforts to thank Canada, not only for its help that he says is already saving thousands of lives in terms of economic, humanitarian, and military aid, but also, he says, really to be on the right side of history, standing up and fighting for justice. He did make a point to mention genocide at least seven times, directly accusing Russia and Moscow under the leadership of Vladimir Putin of this heinous crime, comparing it as well to the brutal Holodomor, of course, the starvation of so many Ukrainians during the time of the Soviet Union. So very much a speech that was powerful, direct, thanking Canada, but of course urging continued support.
And on that note, the Ukrainian president did make it clear that their country's success or failure relies on military aid. So is Canada's new commitment enough?
Yes, and we'll have to see. I think this is the big issue here for Ukraine, that as much as President Zelensky was very complimentary of the support he's getting from Canada, and also very thankful that it is a longer-term $650 million pledge that would, with supplies and training and equipment, this is the type of support he's looking for, because this is turning out to be a very long, drawn-out battle of attrition, a war that Ukraine simply cannot win if it cannot get more supplies. There is a huge bill that would give more spending from the United States. I asked the President Zelensky about this today. $24 billion could also go towards Ukraine, but there is division amongst some Republicans in Congress as to whether that money should be released. This is causing some anxiety, I'm sure, for Ukraine today. President Zelensky seemed assured that he felt the United States, who's been really one of the largest supporters of military aid and finances, will come through for him. But there are some other early holes in the line from what was a very united NATO front. Even lately, Poland has said that it will stop sending military aid to Ukraine, once a major booster of its neighboring country, now saying it needs to make sure it arms its own troops with more modern equipment, Sean.
CTV's Kevin Gallagher joining us live from Ottawa. Thank you very much.
And here is a look at Volodymyr Zelensky arriving in downtown Toronto this very hour. This is a live shot from our CTV News chopper. The plane just touching down. You can see the entourage there. A lot of people noting today the level of security surrounding Zelensky's visit. Not entirely surprising. Our John Musselman is live downtown with more, awaiting the arrival in our very city. John, what can you tell us? What's happening there?
Well, Michelle, we can tell you that Zelensky will be making two appearances in downtown Toronto tonight, one at a hotel, another not far from Exhibition Place. There is massive security presence at both locations, and there is security issues about location until a later time. But we did speak to people about Zelensky coming to Canada to speak. Here's what they had to say.
He obviously wants Canadian support, and I think it's probably a good call for him to come try to do that.
Ukraine is definitely been put in a tight spot, and they have to defend themselves. So
I think it's a great chance for Canada to step up and not just talk, but really put money where our mouths are. And hopefully we can help Ukrainians, because what's going on is horrific.
You know, he has to go wherever he can find help. He has to reach out to people who will listen, and hopefully Canadians are on that side.
We'll take you to a live shot now from the CTV helicopter near Pearson Airport, where the entourage has landed and will make their way downtown to both of these venues. Again, we will be attending the second venue this evening, where a lot of the Ukrainian-Canadian community will be present to hear him speak to this crowd. And we'll have much more on this story tonight on CTV News at 11:30. Reporting live, I'm John Musselman. I'll send it back to you.
Thanks, John. And as Canada pledges new aid, the U.S. is reportedly stepping up its own military assistance to Ukraine. Multiple news outlets, including NBC, say U.S. President Joe Biden has said Washington will send a new type of long-range missile to Kyiv so it can better hit targets in Russian territory during its counteroffensive. Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky did not comment today when asked to confirm those reports. This comes as Poland's government said this week it won't be sending any more arms to Ukraine. This comes as a dispute over grain prices highlights cracks in the ties between the two neighbors.
Meanwhile, Ukrainian officials say 15 civilians were hurt in a Russian strike today on a city in the Donetsk region. Police shared this footage of the destruction, saying one residential building was directly hit. Russia, meantime, says a service member is missing after Ukraine launched a strike on its Navy headquarters on the occupied Crimean Peninsula.
The PM was also asked today about Canada's ongoing tensions with India. He said Ottawa has shared details with New Delhi on credible allegations its agents were involved in the killing of a Canadian citizen and Sikh activist in British Columbia.
We did that many weeks ago, and we are there to work constructively with India, and we hope that they engage with us so that we can get to the bottom of this very serious matter.
The Prime Minister shared those allegations on the killing of Hardeep Singh Najjar on Monday. The White House National Security Advisor weighed in on reports that the U.S. might keep quiet on the matter as it tries to improve ties with India.
I firmly reject the idea that there is a wedge between the U.S. and Canada. We have deep concerns about the allegations, and we would like to see this investigation carried forward and the perpetrators held to account. That is what the United States has stood for from the moment this emerged in public, and we will continue to stand for that until this fully plays its way out.
India's government has lashed out in response to claims against it, issuing travel advisories for its citizens in this country and halting visa services for Canadians. Both sides have also expelled senior diplomats.
The auto workers union is turning up the heat south of the border, promising to expand its strike against major manufacturers.
We're not going to wait around forever for a fair contract at the big three. The companies know how to make this right. The public is on our side, and the members of the UAW are ready to stand up.
The United Auto Workers president announced today members were walking out of 38 more General Motors and Stellantis plants across 20 states. Ford was spared additional strikes as the union says it's meeting some demands during ongoing negotiations. Workers are pushing for a 36% wage increase over 4 years. Companies have offered around half that amount.
In Washington, all eyes are on Congress as U.S. government shutdown looms. House Speaker Kevin McCarthy is trying to get a funding bill passed with his narrow Republican majority.
We continue to talk. Look, I thought we had a really good conference the night before. I thought we had moved two people, but we moved two people the other way, too. So it's a yin and a yang.
Right now, the U.S. government is only funded until the end of the month. Even if the stopgap bill passes the Republican House, it likely faces long odds in the Democratic Senate. A White House official said federal agencies would be told today to start preparing for a shutdown.
Meanwhile, a U.S. senator and his wife are facing charges for allegedly taking bribes of cash, gold, and a luxury car for a range of corrupt acts. Prosecutors say a search of the home of Bob Menendez turned up $100,000 in gold bars and $480,000 in hidden cash. The indictment alleges Menendez provided sensitive U.S. government information and took other steps to secretly help Egypt. The New Jersey Democrat stepped down from a top Senate post, but he's also facing calls to resign.
Crews in Colombia say they've managed to get a massive wildfire impacting several cities under control. Over 100 firefighters were called in to tackle the raging flames outside the country's third largest city. High winds have made it difficult for crews to completely knock down the fire, but officials say the risk of damage to homes has been ruled out. So far, no injuries have been reported.
And wildfire concerns flared up again overnight on the Italian island of Sicily. Firefighters were called in to battle back several fires around Palermo, fueled by high temperatures and strong winds. Several air tankers were called in to support the operations. The fire department said crews were busy for hours and intervening more than 40 times to keep flames from spreading near the city. Back here at home, he died in the line of duty. Today, a four-legged member of the Toronto Police Service is being remembered and celebrated.
His name was Bingo, and he was shot and killed while searching for a suspect in Etobicoke in July.
A procession to remember and say goodbye to a dog and trusted colleague of the Toronto Police Service. Bingo, the 2-year-old German Shepherd, killed this summer in the line of duty.
When Bingo arrived on scene at a call, every officer knew. They knew that he would do everything possible to back them up. For these reasons and many more, Bingo will forever be remembered as a protector.
At Bingo's memorial, he was described as a brave police dog who worked tirelessly to track down suspects and keep the community safe. Officers say he embraced his role and bonded with many in the service. His loss most profound for his handler, Sergeant Brandon Smith.
I've had pets all my life and never thought I could have a stronger connection than a beloved pet. But after spending every day with Bingo, both at work and at home, more often spending more time with him than with Heather and my children, we developed a bond that is deeper than that of a pet.
In July, Bingo was killed when officers attended an apartment in the area of Dixon and Kipling to arrest a man for second-degree murder. According to the Special Investigations Unit, when officers arrived, the man took off and was later found in a backyard. At some point during the interaction, the SIU says the suspect was wounded and Bingo was shot and killed. This sense of loss at the gathering today echoed by Toronto's mayor.
I want to extend my deepest condolence to you, Sergeant Brandon Smith, and the entire Toronto Police Service for the loss you have suffered. The bond between a police dog and handler is truly a special one.
A solemn ceremony for Bingo, attended by dozens of people, including police dog services and other Ontario canine units.
Coming up on CTV News, Toronto's landscape transformed into an all-night art exhibition. Nuit Blanche is back this weekend. We've got a preview of this year's theme and a heads up on extended subway service.
And I'm Pat Foran. Coming up on Consumer Alert, Health Canada is warning of the dangers of water beads. The small beads are used in some toys, and when placed in water, they can grow up to 1,500 times their size. Some children have been severely injured after ingesting them. I'll have my reports just ahead.
We sign off the unofficial summer season as we head in towards the day tomorrow. And whether you're heading out tonight or going out tomorrow, it's going to be a fantastic forecast. For Nuit Blanche, though, there's a ton of installations around the city. So if you want to get out and enjoy it, you won't really need too much in the way of layers. Temperature-wise, quite comfortable. We start off at about 17 and we head into about 14 for the low tonight. So it will be really pleasant to get out and spend some time outdoors. And if you're heading out tomorrow, even nicer weather is on the way. It is going to be the kind of weekend you want to spend as much time outside as possible. It is going to be absolutely fantastic. And stay with us. We have another great night of programming right here on CTV.
There have been several warnings lately with regards to small objects like button batteries and magnets that can be harmful if ingested.
Well, you can add one more to that list. Water beads expand when placed in water and are responsible for hundreds of children being injured. Here's Pat Foran and Consumer Alert. Pat.
Thanks, Sean and Michelle. Water beads are small and colorful and can be found in a range of products and toys. Even though they're tiny, they grow dramatically in water and can be dangerous if babies or toddlers eat them or put them in their nose or ears.
They're marketed as safe and non-toxic sensory toys. Water beads are all the rage. Just soak them in water and watch them grow into slippery, squishy balls of fun. But as Ashley Haugen found out, fun can quickly turn terrifying. Her 13-month-old daughter got a hold of her older sister's water beads.
One morning, Kipley woke up and she was vomiting.
Thinking Kipley had a stomach flu and needed fluids, Ashley took her to the emergency room. Once there, the doctor told her they would need to perform surgery immediately.
He showed us a picture of what he had found in Kipley's small intestine. It was water bead material.
Health Canada issued an advisory earlier this year saying water beads may pose life-threatening risks to young children as they can grow up to 1,500 times their size when placed in water. Water bead accidents have been linked to an estimated 4,500 emergency room visits over a four-year period, according to the Consumer Product Safety Commission. They can contribute to hearing loss, infections, bowel obstructions, blocked airways, and even death.
I've talked to so many parents who bought them for their older children, but then somehow their younger children got them. They're very easy to spill and get lost in someone's house. And then once they're inside their bodies, those water beads can continue to expand in their intestines or even in their lungs.
Another problem, symptoms from ingesting a water bead can seem like an ordinary stomach bug.
Doctors can have a hard time diagnosing that a water bead is to blame because often they don't even show up on an x-ray.
Kipley is now 7, and Ashley is warning other parents about the dangers no matter the age of the child.
They should not sell water beads as toys. They should not market water beads as toys. They are not safe.
They may be an interesting toy, but if you have small children in your home or that visit, water beads may not be worth the risk. Consumer Reports recommends getting rid of them immediately. On your side, I'm Pat Foran.
If you have a consumer story idea, email us at alert@ctv.ca.
Can you believe it? This is the last day of summer. We welcome fall early tomorrow morning, but fortunately, we do have really gorgeous conditions to ring in the new season.
Yeah, not much to complain about this weekend. On the weather front, CTV's Jessica Smith is outside making the best of it. Jess?
Sean, Michelle, it has been a fantastic end to the week temperature-wise, and as far as our condition goes, high pressures kept us nice and clear. Down here at Berksley Park, ahead of the Just for Laughs Festival, it has been a beautiful way to kind of kick things off. Weather is brought to you by Train, the most reliable heating and cooling brand. It's hard to stop a train. Now, temperature-wise, as we kick off our evening, really right across the country, relatively comfortable. Now, as we make our way in towards our low tonight, we don't lose much of that daytime heating, and we will stay just above the seasonal average for us here in the city by about 3 degrees. But really, everybody is holding on to temperatures pretty comfortable. A little cooler the further east you go through Bancroft. For example, they'll be at 4, the norm is 7 this time of year. Now, getting into the day tomorrow, another daytime high just above the seasonal mark. We'll see a decent amount of sunshine and another high UV index. So keep that in mind. No, we are not officially in the summer season anymore. The astronomical start to autumn begins Saturday at 3 a.m. or just before 3 a.m. But you still want to protect yourself the exact same way. But right across southern Ontario, really, really beautiful to get through the day tomorrow. We're looking at daytime highs in the low 20s, so just above that normal mark. Our satellite and radar picture showing you a little disturbance making its way through parts of northern Ontario. And we're watching a system making its way up from south of the border that is primarily affecting areas through New York along the Atlantic coast. It will kind of tiptoe its way into Quebec and parts of Atlantic Canada as we head into the day on Sunday. But taking a look through our kind of forecast radar picture as we head through the next couple of hours, really and truly, it is going to be quite beautiful. Just a few light clouds tonight. As we get into the day tomorrow, a decent amount of sunshine. And really, as we step in towards Sunday, more of the same. Sunday does come with more cloud cover, and the bulk of that active weather really is likely to stay in towards eastern Ontario. So we're not dealing with a ton in the way of any kind of extreme weather, at least here around the GTA, the GTHA. Just a decent amount of cloud cover. A lot of that rain, again, staying areas kind of east of Oshawa. As we get in towards the next 7 days, we kick off the fall season tomorrow with a beautiful forecast. Again, we're just above that seasonal average at about 22. Our overnight lows, though, we stay above average really over the next 7 days. So keep that in mind. It's nothing extreme, but a little bit warmer than it should be for this time of year. Your Sunday looking to be absolutely beautiful. And as we tiptoe into the first full week of autumn, we are going to start off just above seasonal. And then we get in towards Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. We dip down to right around 18 degrees, but overall, it is going to be absolutely fantastic to get out and enjoy all that the city has to offer. I'll send things back inside to you guys.
Thank you, Jess. Sounds great. Well, the City of Toronto is piloting a new program that'll see some bylaw officers carry out their duties on bike.
Biking not only has health benefits for officers, but I'm also confident that this will enhance their ability to improve patrols in larger areas, including parks and high traffic zones like Yonge Dundas Square, where parking is really limited.
21 bylaw enforcement officers will use bikes whenever possible through the spring, summer, and fall. This pilot is part of the city's net zero efforts. The goal is to transition 20% of the city's fleet to zero emission vehicles by the year 2025 and 50% by the year 2030.
Also tonight, cautious optimism in Hollywood as the big studio CEOs remain at the table talking with union negotiators for another day. Could a deal be in the future? The latest on the writer's strike.
This has made you a target.
Five crucial questions to expose the truth. Who's at risk?
Your life is in danger.
Yeah, it is.
What needs to change?
He made a mistake.
That's stunning.
When will justice be done?
The horrible nightmare. This can't be true.
Where's the proof?
Forensic evidence always tells the truth.
Why did this happen? One team uncovers the stories that need to be told.
Canadians should be very concerned.
Watch W5 at a new day and time this October on CTV.
There are some encouraging updates out of Calgary after an E. coli outbreak at daycare has made hundreds of children ill. Officials there say six children now remain in hospital as they battle a complication affecting their blood and kidneys. Two of them are on dialysis. There have been about 350 lab-confirmed cases since the outbreak began 2 weeks ago. Multiple daycares were affected. A central kitchen is believed to have been the source of the outbreak.
The U.S. is now one step closer to rolling out a vaccine to expecting mothers aimed at protecting their newborns from RSV. A panel of vaccine experts has recommended Pfizer's RSV shot be given to women in the middle of their third trimesters. The goal would be to prevent severe disease in infants who are considered at higher risk alongside the elderly. The advice still has to receive final sign-off from the new director of the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. Today, her focus was on the ongoing threat from COVID-19.
Everyone gets an updated vaccine, but we have others, testing, treatment, and other common sense solutions. And yes, masking is one of those solutions that folks could choose to use to protect themselves from this virus.
The American Academy of Pediatrics says COVID hospitalizations have risen faster in recent months than those among adults. The CDC says it expects the total number of people admitted due to COVID, RSV, and flu this year to be similar to last and higher than pre-pandemic levels. And our online team has a closer look at what you need to know about the respiratory virus season as we head into the fall and winter, including the latest advice from public health experts. Their coverage is on our website, ctvnewstoronto.ca.
Well, all eyes are on Hollywood this evening as at least one of the ongoing entertainment strikes inches closer to a possible resolution. The Writers Guild of America has been on strike for more than 4 months, calling for improved wages and job protections. Negotiators were meeting today with studio representatives for the third day in a row. While few details have been officially released, the ongoing talks prompted optimism among some industry insiders. Others told Variety that they're a little more skeptical.
Rockers Blink-182 are out with two fresh tracks as they prepare for an album release.
From strangers into brothers, from brothers into strangers once again.
Their song, One More Time, reflects on their journey as a band, breaking up and coming back together. The track shares its title with Blink-182's upcoming comeback album, which is out October 20th.
And singer rapper Doja Cat is out with a new single and music video for her track Agora Hills. It came the same day as Doja dropped her fourth studio album titled Scarlet. She indicated she was trying to go for more of a rap feel this time around, citing frustration with pop music. Doja Cat will tour Scarlet starting on Halloween, with a stop in Toronto coming in December.
And the first trailer is out for Netflix's reality show based on its smash hit series, Squid Game. The Korean show was Netflix's most watched of all time. And while nobody will die in real life, the reality series will see 456 contestants compete in a range of games and challenges to try and emerge victorious. The winner gets $4.56 million U.S., by far the biggest ever prize for a reality TV competition.
Stars Tonight is brought to you by Last Man's Bad Boy. Who's better? Nobody.
We just need more transparency in government in general, and for our leaders to not take the public's intelligence for granted.
Updating our top stories, it was another busy day at Queen's Park with Ontario's Labour Minister Monte McNaughton becoming the third Ford cabinet minister to resign in under a month. His exit to join the private sector follows Steve Clark, the former housing minister, and Khalid Rashid, the former minister of public and business service delivery. It also comes just a day after the premier reversed Greenbelt land swap plans.
This demonstrates progress that we can work together to put our kids first.
ETFO, the Elementary Teachers Federation of Ontario, representing 3,500 education workers, has reached a tentative deal with the provincial government. The union's president says compensation, working conditions, and support for students were key issues brought to the table.
Russia's destruction of Mariupol, of Volnovakha, or Bakhmut, or any other city or village in Ukraine must not go unpunished.
Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky visited Parliament Hill today, thanking Canada for its support since the Russian invasion. Prime Minister Trudeau also pledged more aid for Ukraine. Zelensky recently landed in Toronto. We will have more coverage tonight at 11:30. And remember to keep up to date day and night through our website, ctvnewstoronto.ca, and by downloading the CTV News app. And if you have a news tip, photos or video of breaking news, let us know.
In business, the rapid September run-up in oil prices is now slowing. With more, here's Andrew Bell from BNN Bloomberg.
Hello there. Oil prices ended this week little changed, with North American crude trading at just over $90 US a barrel. But the price has jumped more than $10 since August as the Saudis and Russians keep supplies off the market. And this week, Russia moved to cut its exports of diesel, sparking a sharp rally of the fuel used in heating, heavy transport and industry worldwide. Let's check in on the markets. The Canadian dollar was at 74.17 US cents, up a fraction. Oil settled at $90.03, up 40 cents. Western Canadian Select Oil traded at $71.84 US a barrel, up 76 cents. And the TSX Composite ended the week at 19,779.97, down just under 12 points. That's the latest in business. I'm Andrew Bell of BNN Bloomberg.
Canada Post says it's reviewing how it uses customer data after facing some flack from the Federal Privacy Commissioner. The watchdog said Canada Post was tracking information on people's addresses and the types of online shopping they do based on the outsides of envelopes and packages. That data was then used to build marketing lists the corporation rents to businesses. Canada Post says it's committed to privacy rules and will take another look at its programs.
Amazon Prime Video is set to become the latest streaming service to include ads on its platform. Amazon Prime members have access to the company's video service as part of a range of benefits like faster shipping. But as other companies turn to ads for more revenue, Prime Video will soon charge a monthly fee to viewers who don't want to see them. That change to the service is set to begin early next year in Canada, the U.S., and other countries.
Tonight, a social side effect of the rising cost of living. New numbers point to a generational shift as more and more young Canadians choose not to have children. We'll take a look at the reasons why and the impact. That story more later on CTV National News.
And a reminder, the CTV News at 6 podcast is available as a download every weeknight. And a special shout out to those of you listening to the newscast live right now on News Talk 1010.
In sports, the Blue Jays wrapped up their series with the New York Yankees last night. It was a slow start for the Jays, but they picked it up in the ninth inning with two runs. It just wasn't enough to catch up to the Yankees. New York went on to take the win 5-3. The Jays' series against the Tampa Bay Rays is just getting underway this evening.
And the Toronto Maple Leafs have held a couple of on-ice practice sessions as they get set for the new season. Players ran through some fitness and skating drills in two sessions at the Ford Performance Center in Etobicoke. The Leafs open the 2023-2024 season against Montreal on October 11th, but there are still plenty of questions as to what the forward lines will look like.
They're moving Willie Nylander to center to try that out because they essentially brought in five new wingers in Tyler Bertuzzi, Max Domi, Ryan Reeves, Matthew Nyes is getting his first full season with the Leafs, and then hopefully Nick Robertson can stay healthy for them this year. So they're just juggling everything around. And a Leafs team with, on paper, really no holes this year, it's a very, very exciting time in Toronto.
The Leafs open the preseason this Sunday in Ottawa.
Toronto's free all-night art exhibition returns tomorrow night. Nuit Blanche brings together hundreds of contemporary artists with projects featured across the city in a celebration that goes from sundown to sunup. This year's theme, Breaking Ground, invites artists to explore ideas centered on the natural world, change, and innovation.
It is one of the most magical nights of the city. When we sort of turn over public space to artists who transform parts of the city that you may walk by every day into something magical.
The TTC is extending subway service for the art festival, with service running all night. You can find a full list of Nuit Blanche exhibits, locations on the city's websites. Well, lots to be excited about this weekend.
And the weather will cooperate. Here's Jess.
It really has been a beautiful end to the week. We've seen a decent amount of sunshine today, a really light wind out of the east, and that really carries us through the rest of our night. Taking a look at our satellite and radar board, there's really not a lot going on. That's all thanks to high pressure, keeping the sky nice and clear. Now, temperature-wise, right around southern Ontario, the Golden Horseshoe in particular, really beautiful. And over the next 7 days, we hover just above seasonal. That's really until we get in towards the middle of next week, and it is going to be absolutely stunning. Although a little cooler, that really is right where we should be for this time of year. And a reminder about the new Lotto 649 with two big jackpots to win. One on one ticket, Saturday's classic jackpot is $5 million, and the new gold ball jackpot is $66 million. You can head to olg.ca for more information. And Sean and Michelle, I don't know about you guys, but there is so much happening down here at the Just for Last Festival. It's going to be great. There's Nuit Blanche. There's never not something to do in the city. I'll send things back inside to you guys.
Our city is awesome. Thank you, Jess. And be sure to join Omar Sachedina tonight at 11 for CTV National News, followed by Zoraida Allman with our next local newscast at 11:30.
In the meantime, our coverage continues anytime on CP24 and online at ctvnewstoronto.ca.
For Jessica Smith and all of us here at CTV News, thank you for watching and have a great weekend.